ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। ओ रामकृष्ण द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ द इटर्नल रिलिजन द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलिजन्स एंड द बेस्ट ऑफ ऑल इनकॉर्नेशंस वी सैल्यूट दी। इन द लास्ट रीडिंग क्लास वी स्टॉप्ड एट पैरा नंबर 18 पेज नंबर 353। वी शैल कंटिन्यू टुडे फ्रॉम पैरा 18 ऑन द सेम पेज। Tota remained sitting for a long time beside the master, who entered into samadhi in the manner mentioned above. So we heard in the last reading that Sri Ramakrishna sat for practicing samadhi or for getting into samadhi, and Tota instructed him in every way, and he went and merged into samadhi. 3 days were over, but he was not coming down. So from there the topic continues. Tota remained sitting for a long time beside the master, who entered into samadhi in the manner mentioned above. Then coming out of the hut silently, he locked the door up, lest someone should enter the hut without his knowledge and disturb Sri Ramakrishna. He took his seat under the panchavati not far from the hut and was awaiting the master's call to open the door. He expected that master would come down from samadhi after a few hours at least. Then he would call for the door to be opened. It had been locked from outside. The day passed into night. Slowly and calmly days rolled on. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days rolled on. At the end of 3 days, when Tota did not still hear the master's call, he was filled with curiosity and astonishment and left his seat to open the door. With a view to knowing the condition of his disciple, he entered the hut and saw that the master was sitting in the same posture in which he had left him, and that there was not the slightest function of the vital force in his body. The pranas had stopped working, but his face was calm and serene and full of effulgence. He understood that the disciple was completely dead to the external world, and that his mind merged in Brahman was calm and motionless, like an unflickering lamp in a windless place. So that is the characteristic of the samadhi. So the mind is steady, it doesn't flicker, just like a lamp kept in a windless place. Being versed in the mystery of samadhi, Tota became astounded and thought, "Is this indeed true that I see enacted before me? That is the Sri Ramakrishna getting into samadhi at the very first instance. Has this great soul actually realized in 1 day what I could experience only as a result of 40 years of austerity, austere sadhana?" Filled with doubt, Tota applied his mind to the examination of the state of the master and scrutinized minutely all the signs manifested in the disciple's body. He examined especially whether his heart was beating and whether the slightest breath was coming out of his nostrils. He touched repeatedly the disciple's body, which was in a steady posture, like a piece of wood, firm and fixed. But there was no sign of any change or modification, nor was there any return of normal consciousness. Besides himself with joy and astonishment, Tota cried out, "Is it divine Maya? Is it truth? Is it in truth samadhi? Is it the nirvikalpa samadhi, the ultimate result attained through the path of knowledge spoken of in the Vedanta? Oh, how very strange is the maya of the divine, devi maya. How strange. Tota tried to bring the master down. Tota then undertook the process of bringing the disciple back to the consciousness of the external world. Profound sounds of the mantra, Hari Om, filled the land, water and sky of the Panchavati. He started repeating, Hari Om, Hari Om. We have described in another place how attracted by the love of his disciple and desirous of making him firmly established in the nirvikalpa plane of consciousness, Sri Tota spent here day after day and month after month, and how, with the help of the master, he had his own spiritual life made complete in all respects. We refrain, therefore, from repeating all that here. Having lived continuously at Dakshineshwar for 11 months, Tota started for the northwestern parts of the country. There arose immediately after this event a strong determination in the master's mind to remain incessantly thenceforward in the non-dual plane of consciousness. We have told the reader elsewhere how he carried the same into practice, how he could remain continually for 6 months in that high state of non-duality, and where even adhikarika persons, that is the extraordinarily gifted spiritual seekers, who are only a little less than the incarnations of God, cannot dwell for such a long time. Not to speak of the ordinary sadhakas, the jivakotis, and how at that time a monk arrived at the Kali temple and coming to know that humanity would be greatly benefited through the master in the future, lived there for 6 months, taking care of his body and saved his life by various means. This story is told in detail in the second part. So, master was for in 3 days, he had attained to the, in the first instance itself, first day itself he went into Samadhi. It took 3 days for the Guru to find out that he is not coming down. So on the third day, he brought his mind down. Otherwise, we don't know how long he would have remained there. Perhaps he would have remained permanently there. We should now mention a special event that happened in Mathur Bapu's life by the grace of the master at that time and bring this chapter to an end. Mathur's devotion to and faith in the master had already been increased enormously as a result of his seeing various wonderful divine powers manifested in the master. An event at this time confirmed and stabilized that devotion of his, making Mathur take absolute refuge in the master for his entire life. Mathur's second wife, Srimati Jagadamba Dasi, had an attack of dysentery. The disease gradually worsened so much that the well-known doctors and physicians of Calcutta at first felt anxious for her life and then gave up all hope. Mathur, though born poor, was, we were told by the master, exceedingly good-looking, and it was because of this that Rani Rasmani gave her third daughter, Karunamayi, in marriage to him. And after her death, the youngest Jagadamba Dasi. Therefore, immediately after his marriage, a profound change took place in his circumstances, and within a short time, he rose to be the right-hand man of his mother-in-law on account of his address and intelligence. We have already narrated how, after the death of Rani Rasmani, he acquired in a way the sole authority for the management of the Rani's property. Not only was Mathur now going to lose his nearest wife Jagadamba Dasi, but he was on the point of being simultaneously deprived of the said authority over the management of the mother-in-law's property. It is therefore needless to say that about his mental condition when the doctors gave up the case of Jagadamba Dasi as hopeless. He became extremely anxious and came to Dakshineshwar, and after saluting the mother of the universe, went to the Panchavati in search of the master. Seeing him in that bewildered condition, the master asked him very affectionately to sit by him and made enquiries about its cause. Mathur fell at the feet and with a choked voice informed him everything with tears in his eyes, piteously saying again and again, "The worst is about to happen, but that apart, what grieves me most, father, is that I am going to be deprived of the privilege of serving you." See, he gives priority to the service of the master than the death of his dearest wife. Filled with compassion on seeing the miserable plight of Mathur, the master entered into an ecstasy and said to him, "Don't be afraid, your wife will come round." The devout Mathur knew the master as God himself, and so at the master's assurance he was, as it were, brought back to life and took leave of him that day. On his return to Jan Bazaar, he found that there is a sudden change for the better in the condition of the patient. Within a few hours, there he said, "Your wife will come round." By the time he comes home, after an hour or two, he finds from the dreadful disease which had made the doctors give up the hope of her life, it had come down and she had coming to normal. "Jagadamba Dasi," said the master, "was gradually coming round from that day, and her sufferings from the disease had to be borne by this body," showing his own. So Sri Ramakrishna has taken upon himself all the bad karma for which she had to suffer death. All the karma he has taken over. That is how she has been relieved and she was recovering from the point of death. "As the consequence of bringing round Jagadamba Dasi, I had to suffer from dysentery and other diseases for 6 months. An avatar purusha to suffer for 6 months, what tremendous load of sins should have been there, which he has happily taken over upon himself for the sake of his devotee." Fantastic to even imagine that the guru can have so much of kindness on his disciple. Speaking of the wonderful loving service of Mathur to him, one day the master referred to the aforesaid event and said to us, "Was it for nothing that Mathur served me for 14 years? The Divine Mother showed him various wonderful powers through showing his body this. That is why he served so devoutly." So we come to the end of the 14th chapter, 15th chapter, we come to the chapter 16, epilogue of the master's Vedanta sadhana and his practice of Islam. Now the master's strong body was shattered and he suffered from illness for a few months. Either as a result of his curing the fatal disease of Jagadamba Dasi, as mentioned above, or of his superhuman efforts for 6 long months to dwell continually in the plane of the non-dual consciousness, We were told by him that he had then a severe attack of dysentery. His nephew Hriday engaged himself in nursing him day and night. Mathur placed him under the treatment of Ganga Prasad Sen, the famous physician, and made special arrangements for his diet, etc. Although his body was so severely ill, the extraordinary calmness and the incessant bliss enjoyed by his mind, freed from the body consciousness, beggared description. His mind would separate itself from the body, the disease, and all other objects of the world at the slightest suggestion, and would soar to the faraway Nirvikalpa plane at once. He would soar into the realm of God. No sooner did it hear the word of Brahman, Self, or Ishvara than it merged in its content, forgetting all other things and its own separate existence for some time. So one word was enough. Word about Brahman, he would fly into Samadhi. Therefore, it is clear that in spite of that severe pain in his body, owing to the fury of the disease, he actually felt very little of it. He did not feel the pain was there in the body, and the body, nerves and muscles, etc. His soul was separated, as it were, so he did not feel any pain at all. On the other side, he was merged in bliss. Incessantly, he was merged in joy of Atman. But that pain due to the disease, we heard from the Master himself, brought down his mind at times from high planes of spiritual experience and made it conscious of his body. The Master said it was during this period that the foremost of the Paramahamsas, the followers of the Vedanta, used to come to him. His room was then always reverberating with the sounds of their utterances on the discussion of the Vedantic truths. Not this, not this. Neti, neti. Being, revealing, rejoicing. So, this self is Brahman. I am Atma, Brahma. And so on and so forth. When during the discussions of those high Vedantic dicta, they could not arrive at the right conclusion on any question, the Master had to become the umpire and decide it. He is suffering from all disease, and his thinking about his body itself should be difficult for a person of that illness. But he is acting as an umpire to the abstruse philosophical topics that are being discussed by the great Pandits. Need we say that had he been always distracted like other people on account of the disease, it would never have been possible for him constantly to take part in those abstruse philosophical discussions. So that shows he completely separated himself from the body, what is called Videha Bhava, feeling bodilessness. Though he is a body, he is not attached to the body at all. He becomes loose from the body. Anything happens to the body does not affect him at all. So he is demonstrating it to all others. With such disease, when people cannot even rest peacefully, he is taking part in deep discussions of philosophical issues. By the end of the period, when he was continually in the Nirvikalpa plane, the Master had, we have said elsewhere, a wonderful auditive experience, a realization he was now commanded for the third time to remain in Bhavamukha. Though we call it an auditive experience, the reader should understand by it a realization in his heart of hearts. For the Master did not hear it, unlike as he did twice before, from the mouth of any visible figure. You remain in Bhavamukha. Third time when he heard, it was not like the first two times. But the master's mind had the immediate consciousness of the existence of that idea or will in the cosmic mind of the omnipresent Brahman, as it was remaining most of the time in complete oneness with the absolute, the non-dual being, and at times getting separated from it partially, was realizing that it was a part of the all-pervading Brahman with the attributes, the mother of the universe. You see, the author is trying to tell us that the third time when he heard, remain in Bhavamukha. Remain Bhavamukha means you remain at the threshold of the pure Brahman Samadhi and also the waking state. You will be aware of the world also on one side. On the other side, you will be aware of the Samadhi, the joy of Samadhi also. Very, very difficult thing to understand and very difficult thing to reach. But it is a truth that Sri Ramakrishna had reached that state. He was aware of the world also. He was aware of the God's presence also. So both simultaneously. This is called the Bhava Mukha. So he stayed in that one. And that means he was conscious of this world also and suffering. And he was thinking about the how to relieve the suffering, etc. of the world on one side. On another side, he was merged in Samadhi, enjoying for himself the highest joy, spiritual joy of the Vedanta. On account of that, in that state, he came to know that he was to remain in Bhavamukha. In that state, he had to remain. How long? All through his life. All through his life, Sri Ramakrishna was in this Bhavamukha state. Bhavamukha state is an otherwise called also in Vedanta, Sahaja Samadhi. Samadhi, the absorption in God, has become Sahaja. It's very natural to him. Just naturally, you know, we are aware of this world. He was aware of the Brahman. He was like us in all other things, in the worldly thing. But simultaneously, he was aware that he is Brahman. God alone is there inside him. So he realized that one. On account of that realization, the future purpose of his life stood completely revealed to him. Because he knew that he was told from within himself that he has to remain in this Bhavamukha all his life. What he would be doing in his life, so that was also revealed to him. What he has to achieve in his future life, in the few more years he is going to live, what is he going to do, what he should do, that also he knew. That means he knew the mission of his life. For not standing in need of a body, not at all desires to continue in life, yet commanded again to remain in Bhavamukha according to the inscrutable will of the mother. The master now came to know that he had to live in the body thenceforward in accordance with the will and purpose of the sportive divine, that is Mother Kali, and that he had been so commanded because his body could not continue to live were he to remain eternally identified with Brahman. So the author is telling us, Sri Ramakrishna was asked to remain in Bhavamukha by the Mother Divine, Mother Kali. Why? Not only that he should live and then give the message of all his realizations to the suffering humanity. But otherwise, he would get absorbed in Samadhi and give up his body itself, would go away. So unless a purpose is given to his life, so he would not remain in this body. So Divine Mother ordered him, no, you remain in the dual knowledge of both Brahman and the world. So you realize the sufferings of the world and then give them the all curing panacea for all ills, that is the knowledge of God. So that also you will know because you know God also on one side, and you give this panacea of God knowledge to the suffering world. So suffering world is suffering because it does not know the infinite joy of God. It is running behind small joys, and out of that getting into jealousy, competition, hatred, fight, all these things because of the hunt for pleasure, and which is very, very little in the world. So he was to give the infinite joy of God to the humanity and show a way beyond competition, beyond hatred, and a path of love and bliss and camaraderie and friendship, cooperation and help. So this path he had to show to the world. So a mother gave that as the purpose of his life. You remain in Bhavamukha, she said, for this purpose, and gave a purpose of his life. What will you do staying in your body? You have this infinite knowledge of God as well as the world. You understand the needs of the world. According to that one, you distribute the joy of God, the spiritual joy, to each one, and show him separate paths by pursuing which they will get the lasting joy and real joy. So she ordered him to be in Bhavamukha and gave him also the future mission of his life. He also came to know his former lives. At that time, future of his life, he has come to know. So the author says he came to know of his former lives also through jati smaratva. Jati means the births. Smaratva means the remembrance of. Remembrance of the previous births. So he got all the knowledge of the previous births also. The power of remembering past lives. And that he was an adhikarika person. That means he was an incarnation in the previous births also. Or rather, as an incarnation of God, eternally pure in nature, who now assumed a body and performed austerity, etc., in order to rescue the modern age from the decline of religion and to bring about the well-being of humanity. That was the purpose for which he had to assume the body. Though he is a perfect person himself, he doesn't require to do any spiritual practice to attain to knowledge. But he came to become a guru to instruct thousands and thousands in the path of God realization, Brahman realization. He came to know, moreover, that it was with a view to accomplishing some special purpose of hers, special purpose of the Kali, that the Universal Mother had brought him down on earth into a poor Brahmin family as one devoid of all grandeur of external powers. So she brought this child of hers as a poor Brahmin boy. So there was no grandeur outside. All grandeur was the grandeur of his spiritual knowledge, unequaled. So nobody, no peer to him, absolutely peerless in the field of spirituality. Whoever said anything about spirituality, he said, yes, I know, I have seen it already. He's a fantastic person. Whoever comes and says, however great he may be intellectual scholar, maybe a scientist, maybe a spiritual saint, to everybody he proves unequal. He is far head and shoulders above everyone. So such was his power, spiritual powers. But for outside purposes, so he looked like a poor Brahmin, not having good means for a luxurious life. So he came to know further that only few people would be able to know and understand during his lifetime the mystery of the play of the Divine Mother, and that as soon as the generality of people would begin to understand it, the mother would absorb her child into her own person. But that the spiritual waves which his body and mind would generate would go on surging with ever greater momentum and would bring after his passing away plentitude of well-being to humanity for all time. A great message. So he was revealed that he has to live and he has to preach the spiritual truths that he has realized, and that when he preaches, he would not get very many disciples when he was alive. Hardly a few he may get, but that doesn't mean it will not spread. After he passes away, it will spread like wildfire, envelop the whole world, bringing peace and joy, equality, fraternity everywhere. So that is going to happen. Mother is revealing to him. So he knew everything, that he would preach and what would be the effect of his speech, when it would take effect. Everything he knew, the whole book of nature was open to him. We must remember some of the statements in the scriptures if we are to understand how the master could have those extraordinary experiences. Can one have such experience, knowing the past, knowing the future, knowing every detail of the future also? Is it possible? So the scriptures are the records of all the great saints and seers. So can we get anything from there to corroborate that somebody had attained to this state? The aspirant says, say the scriptures, attains jati-smaratva before he becomes fully established in the pure consciousness itself with the help of the non-dual moon. So when through the Advaitic sadhana anyone realizes the Advaitic experience that I and Brahman are one, that means the selfish I will disappear. Brahman alone remains in the place of the selfish I. So this knowledge, this Advaitic experience, when it comes just before that one, every one of the aspirant will get this knowledge of the previous births, jati smaratva, and the future of his life also. Itself, in other words, with the fullest development of this remembrance, his memory reaches such a mature state that the entire history of his transmigration, how, where and how many times he had to be encased in bodies and what actions, good or evil, he had performed, is revealed with a terrible vividness. Everyone will come to realize all his past before one realizes the highest Brahman. Consequently, the transitoriness of everything in the world and the futility of the pursuit of worldly enjoyments under being born again and again under the same general conditions are driven home to him. Because he understands all his previous births and he has suffered for whatever he has done, either in that birth itself or in the consequent birth, next birth. So he clearly sees the cause and effect of our previous actions and our present birth. Most of us, we don't know our previous birth. Therefore, we are unable to find out the reason why we are getting this joy or sorrow. But this joy and sorrow has its roots in the another birth, the previous birth. There we have done something good, for that we are getting joy. There was no time to enjoy it in the previous birth. Maybe before our birth, we have endured a huge amount to an orphanage. So hundreds of orphans are benefited by it. So much of merit has accrued, but I am on the deathbed. I cannot enjoy it now. So I give up this body and go. But my good deed must give me joy. So in the next birth, suddenly I get huge wealth and great things of joy. I don't understand, I have not done anything. But I have got this huge wealth and huge enjoyments around me. How? How means you have not done anything in this birth, but that which you have done in the previous birth has come to you through the will of God. God does not allow any good deed to go unrewarded. He has brought it back to you in this second birth, in the next birth. So, but we are unable to connect. Therefore, we wonder and wonder. We don't get a solution. Whereas the great people who attain to Advaitic knowledge, before they attain to that knowledge, all their previous is revealed. And then they know by what actions, what results are produced. So naturally they are given, they go to the mood of renunciation. Because what is the use? You do good and then you get some joy. But that also ends. Then you do some bad and bad effects will come and grief will come. You suffer that also. Then again you do good or bad. Again you enjoy happiness and grief. It is a some going round and round the wheel. So they develop a sort of a renunciative mood towards the world. So there is no wonder in the general conditions are driven home to him. The intense detachment which then arises in the heart frees him from all desires whatsoever. That is how when the realized souls, they don't have any desire at all. It's because of this. They realize the futility. Sri Ramakrishna's teachings, how many times he goes on repeating, you see the enjoyments or sorrows of this world are only momentary. It is here and it goes away. You say you are happy, suddenly some 5 or 10 years pass away and you are in misery. Oh, I am in misery, you are weeping, 5 or 10 years goes away, again you are in gap happiness. So nothing is here permanent. Impermanence is the nature. Anityam asukham lokam imam prapya bhajaswama. Bhagavan Sri Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, is anitya, transitory. There is nothing permanent in this world. So this comes naturally as a lesson because of their having the knowledge of the previous births. They can connect the effect with the cause and then say the cause and effect chain is going on. Let us cut this cause and effect. So we do good and then enjoy good happiness. Again say whatever bad we have done, we undergo sorrow. Again we go on good and doing the bad and get the effects of that one. Where is the end? So cut this chain. Neither do we want to good nor bad. We offer everything at the feet of the Lord. Oh Lord, I only work. I neither want good or bad. So you both the good and bad you take, both the active actions, good and bad action I offer to you. Their effects also, sorrow and joy, that also you take. What do you want then? I want the knowledge of Brahman. I want to know that I am your child. I want to know that I am part and parcel of you, the infinite Brahman. This is all I want. I want your grace. I don't want any other remuneration. I don't want anything from what I do. So this is how the man of realization feels and teaches others also. The Upanishad says that the results of such persons always come true. So they are, their blessings are amogha, unfailing. When they say something, it must come true. And their mind through samadhi can perceive any sphere they like, whether of God or forbears or of any other beings. They can reach any part of this whole entire universe. It is not a planet here or there, a star here or there. Beyond the parent planets and stars, there are the places where devatas are there, gods and goddesses are there, and there also hierarchy are there, ordinary gods and goddesses, superior gods, kings of them, the kings of gods like Indra. So Indra is above Agni and Vayu, etc. Above Indra there is Brihaspati. Above Brihaspati there is Chaturmukha Brahma. So hierarchy is there. So their abodes are also like that, a sort of a higher and higher level. So one can go, they can go into any sphere. These people have realized Brahman. By a single wish, they can enter into any sphere and know what is happening there. Patanjali, the great sage, mentions in his Yoga Sutras that all kinds of yogic powers are attained by such persons. So many inscrutable powers will come to them. Again, the author of the Panchadashi, Vidyaranya, synthesizing this apparent contradiction coexisting in the same person, namely the attainment of yogic powers and the absence of desires. You have got power, but you have no desire at all to use that power. What is the good of that power? So, but these exist. It is fact. Those people have got power, but they don't use it at all. I have no use. Sri Ramakrishna himself told Sri Narendra, "Narendra, I have got all the Ashta Siddhis, the yogic powers are there. I have no use for them. So I want to hand it over to you. You may have use. Will you take?" He said, "No, I don't want. I want only God realization. After realizing God, I will know whether it is useful for me, whether it is necessary to have it. Then I will come to you. Not now. Don't give me." See, the real guru, real the shishya also. That is how they have powers, no desires to use it. Because they are completely, their desires are fulfilled. Apta kama. They have attained all the desires. So, see, he says that this power, the absence of desire, says that although they attain such wonderful powers, they never apply them to further their own interests for the simple reason that they do not have any such desire. Absolutely dependent on the will of God, the Adhikarika persons, that is the incarnations, alone amongst them apply at times those powers for the well-being of the many. That is why the author of Panchadashi says that such a person has the power but not the urge to change the worldly circumstances in which he attains the knowledge of Brahman and spends his time in that state. So the realized persons live like any one of us in this world. They can change the whole world itself if they want. They do not do it because they don't desire to do it. Why do they don't desire? That is the nature. There is no use. It is absolutely useless to try to change this one to another. World should be like this only. Its nature is there as God has created it. Allow it to go in its own way. But spiritual knowledge gives you a freedom. In spite of what is there in the external world, let it go in the normal way. But we will be super normal inside our mind, inside our heart, with the knowledge of Brahman. So many more such truths are revealed in the next class. We will take them up in the next class. Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ishavataram parameshamidyam tam ramakrishnam shirasanamamah. O Ramakrishna, the taintless one, the eternal one, the one with infinite forms, the one who has assumed form out of compassion to the devotees, the one who is the incarnate of the Supreme Soul, and the one who is the adorable Lord of all, we salute thee, bowing our heads before you. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.